I don't know, Hashim, what is your experience from working with end users who just use OMNeT for the simulation? Is automotive one of the key topics for that?
Statistics and
compare with IDE.
Yeah. Mm. But it's definitely not an upcoming topic. I think it's becoming more and more important.
So it's more driven by the community than by end users in this case. It's just a general thing that I'm not working to particular or ad hoc or hard to hard communication, but it seems to me like, okay, it's the current buzz topic. Whenever there's a bus stop, people go in this direction. Always OMNeT and other simulators too. So a couple of years ago, okay, it was sensor networks, it was slightly physical systems, which apparently is not the big topic for OMNeT, probably for other systems. But vehicle networks seems to be a big topic since Sumo and Island got together.
After taking it and doing electric cars, this is something that wasn't even in my mind when I started just putting some things together. The guys in Luxembourg are using Veins and Automotive Simulation stuff. And it's nice to see that. I think for the last year or so, things have been feeding back into things and just fixing the foundation of but basically, this is exactly what I want to have, and what I think should be going on, to have this common basis as a way of just bundling efforts that everyone needs for the research, and then just letting people run with it and building their own simulations out of it. So for the past month, it feels like there's fewer and fewer bug reports coming in, so maybe this is not really safe. Or it has lost all users around. Everyone has just lost all the users. But yeah, and this is why I'm saying that I basically have no idea what it's going on, but I think that's a good thing. Everyone's using it for something that I need. And this is also the reason why I'm trying to push now more and more towards common scenarios. Because what people are using right now in many evaluations, and I keep getting papers already that are basically taking the base tutorial simulation and trying to build something. And just looking at the tutorial simulation is just so brain dead that people leaving the university campus and going for lunch at Hamburg. That is what the base tutorial simulation is. People are trying to build research on top of it. And it seems like they're very successful, so there's something to be made out of that scenario, but it's not what I want. People talk for it, but one people use as a reference as a kind of random waypoint model of vehicle simulation.
this is a bit surprising. I mean, if you are asking for a reference model for the mobility of the cars, right? You are asking for a reference model for the mobility
yes.
of the cars.
Absolutely.
And I mean, all people, all cities who have traffic lights probably do some kind of this simulation.
Mm-hmm.
And I suppose that they also have some kind of reference model.
Yeah, absolutely.
Start from scratch. Why can we not uses, or I mean, probably we don't have access to this type of people at the data, but modeling the mobilities of car in cities is a very common thing that existed, I mean, before we had internet. So I'm surprised that this is really a problem.
Yeah.
I mean, we should just try to, well, these guys who are working on the vehicle as well should try to get them back as a source of people. I don't know.
The reference scenario for modeling mobility, unfortunately, is just a stretch of pipe.
What?
So, Bundesstraße, we have some kilometers of that, some people feeding in, and then some people just getting to the end of it, and then that's it. And this works perfectly well for traffic engineering to get the car following model just calibrated right, the lane change model just calibrated right. But in terms of the networking, especially as urban areas are concerned, it's pretty much useless.
Mm-hmm.
And so when it comes to urban scenarios, I'm talking to them, of course, everyone has a scenario that they're using. They're very happy to share it. If you enter into a cooperation with them, sign an NDA because it's important for the city, and they have all of the traffic light, face timing from the city, and they have network demand from the city. So yeah. But that's not what I think doing the research should be about. Just having a private scenario and saying, well, here's my results. Good luck trying to reproduce them. And I completely see the point of many network people that say, well, obviously I want to evaluate my protocol in the best possible scenario. Or, well, they're not saying best possible scenario, they're saying the use case that my protocol is designed for. But there needs to be a common baseline of saying, hey, this is how my protocol would behave in not the random waypoint model, whatever. And this is how it would behave in let's say, a city at night, which is what I designed. Because this not only gives you the opportunity to reproduce part of the results and say, hey, they got that part right, but also to compare it to what has come before. And this makes it really, really hard. If I start reading a paper on any kind of vehicle networking, I have not the faintest idea of how well the protocol is designed. But basically, for the most part, I see papers that say, okay, we have evaluated our protocol in a baseline configuration as variant A, E, and C, and our big results are variant C as best. And that was for sure a lot of work, but it would be so much more helpful if I compared to a completely different protocol and said, okay, so theirs is a little bit faster or uses a little bit less bandwidth. And right now there's just no way to do it.
Yeah, but which is actually not specific to vehicular network simulation. I mean, this kind of discussion is also in other
I just wanted to add that we have it with the in-car network as well, because the communication matrices that the car manufacturers have are you cannot get them because it's really, they don't get them. And so our idea was to collect data of several open sources and build some sort of a reference model. But to build such a model, we need a lot of people helping to really have a good base. So perhaps this is also an opportunity for a community such as the OMNeT community to find reference models for traffic or for communication matrices and so on.
Yeah, absolutely. But I don't think you can really go to a scientific conference and say, okay, now I'm presenting a paper on a scenario.
Yeah, sure.
And that makes it hard to really have your scenario peer reviewed or to get any kind of sensible feedback. In that sense, the guys from wireless sensor networking probably get it easy because my model is very straightforward. And it feels like the actually no idea how this this converted from leading to bridging or anything like that. Because using one and one right on the background, that doesn't make sense. And using a ton of different sensors connected left and right, that might not even be standard compliant.
Yeah, that's the problem. And actually, in every paper, I have different scenarios. You know, different bandwidths I use, or there are publications that use models that were previously published, but are sometimes quite old. So it's really difficult to compare the different efforts that were made in the last years. And I think it would be great to overcome the problem that we don't have a common scenario also in the IMCAR networking domain.
So maybe if just you and the first two talkers get together and come up with a crazy scenario and say, okay, this is it, we're using it. The rest we just flash on and say, okay, we're also using it.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's actually the only way to do it in a community way. Because I think nobody is gonna pay for that. There's no person saying, okay, we want you to develop the new base scenario, because there's no business model on that. And so we have to do it on our free time or in the scientific field. But then, as you said, you can't publish the paper because that's not science, that's just engineering for tooling. So you asked before, we had floating car data and we had this data for Nuremberg, but it was impossible get this data and get it into Sumo and get the traffic running properly. This takes so much time to get the map sorted out, to get the traffic sorted out. It was impossible. And in the end, you have, well, you have a specific scenario for Nuremberg, which you can maybe share, or maybe not, depends on your contract. So we've had this discussion, we went to Panama, they have a conference that we want a common model for all of us, and we haven't succeeded so far. So we have to change our approach. I don't know. It doesn't work like that. We don't have a scenario. Still, we had one. It helped us collect a scenario, but this turns out to be incredibly slow. I mean, it took us, I don't know, two weeks to simulate an hour in Cologne. So then, so and just that, obviously. So I have no idea how we can fix this.
Actually, the guys from traffic engineering, I think they tried really hard, and they created this huge repository, which they call Planet Sumo.
Yeah.
Right now, I think it contains Tapas Cologne and a stretch of highway. So they it looks like they were able to do it. They have more scenarios in the pipeline, I don't know. The auto sure is also big on that front.
Yeah. I mean, that's the whole reason we coupled this Sumo and OMNeT, because we're network guys and we don't want to deal with the traffic. So, because we're not experts on traffic engineering, but now we have to do the scenario, so we actually do traffic engineering. So we need them to provide us, or as you just mentioned, there are people who have these scenarios. I don't know, we have to bribe them or something, or we have to get a whistleblower to leave the scenarios. I don't know. But it would be a huge benefit for all of us if we had one common validated city scenario where we have traffic at 6 in the morning, at rush hour, at the afternoon. That would be a huge, huge benefit for all of us. We don't have it.
Yeah, but the question is, I mean, why do I mean, it's still a bit unclear for me why we don't have this. I mean, I understand for the in-car people that there may be, closed information because BMW don't want to publish what's happening in the BMW. But for city car traffic, I mean, it should be a little different. I mean, the city itself is a public entity, and why should the city who do traffic planning, this traffic lights, disclose this information?
I don't have any official statement from the city that I can give, but it turns out that it's even impossible to get map data from the city. They do have map data, very precise map data from the city, and they're just not able to share that because it comes from some non-governmental data source and licensed exclusively to the government. As far as, for example, traffic flows in the city goes, I mean, remember one very, very unofficial statement by a traffic engineer who said that don't you dare share this, because with this people can prove that the traffic light is timed in a way that, that will provoke accidents.
I see.
Even if it's not true, I mean, people could just make up anything and say, okay, here we have the precise timing and weight. Because it's not about just hiring a student and putting them next to a traffic light with a stopwatch, because they're all now adaptive and trying to kind of make smart decisions. And they might end up making dumb decisions and the city gets sued. And if you work closely with the city, it's also important to just reverse engineer this, because there's a way of proving that you can use the data that you have anyway. So it makes you out to be the bad guy if you ever come up with a smart scenario. I mean, this might be a reason why people have stayed away from trying to do this. So maybe a way forward would be to just create a fictional city, traffic as close to realistic as possible.
It's not only traffic, it's also the map itself. Even if you take a map from open street map and you convert it, let's say, to a sumo map, you have to put 1 year of time in it to get it properly done, because all the intersections are, like, I don't know, scrambled and they're broken, and then you have traffic jams, which would never happen in real life, just because the conversion from the open street map from it to sumo got wrong at some point, I don't know. And even if you get the floating car data, we have the data for Nuremberg, we got it in the project. You have, like, for every intersection, you have a number of cars that pass there, but you don't have a micro simulation model. And if you want to do intermediate communication, you want the microscopic effects, you know, you want lane changing, so you want the real traffic. So having the numbers doesn't really help. I mean, of course, it's one step. You can validate your model then, but it doesn't generate the traffic you need. So there's a huge gap which we, or I can speak for myself, I cannot bridge this gap.
More gentlemen than expected.
Have more practical question. That Veins is basically a co-simulation. It's like two simulations running next to each other. The ecologically coupled that. So, isn't this limiting the scenario that could be simulated? Like if you want to simulate driver assistance systems where you only simulation control in acceleration and steering and lane changing and whatever behavior required, is that possible with Sumo and Veins?
It kind of is. We are publishing a paper later this year on actually a complete fork of Veins that is called, let's say, that will make it possible to simulate the system. So we have cooperative cruise control, and we have crazy maneuvers in the platoon, be able to make space for others cheering. I'm not even know. But in the end, that means migrating a lot of the simulation to Sumo, having a new driver model in Sumo, and then just remote controlling the driver model in Sumo for a moment.
From the technical perspective, I thought whether it would be possible to, for two simulations, not to talk to each other via socket, but like link together like one program, to use Sumo as a library and include the OMNeT simulation, or OMNeT the library and into a simulation, so they could directly talk to each other via C++ interface. And do you think this would be technically possible? So is Sumo prepared for that kind of integration?
There's a code base of Sumo is huge. I think it's larger than all of the rest of the network simulation. It turns out that traffic engineers now also have to be software engineers maintaining this huge code base, and that pretty much means the API just, I think it's hard enough for them to keep Tracy stable. It's okay. Very, very small socket API, and even that changes with every major release of possible. So I don't know how helpful it would be to refactor Sumo into library. There have been some very nice proposals of offering something like Sumo as a service, just subscribe to some very lightweight API. closely coupled to your simulation, but I'm not aware of the most recent progress on that.
Where's the license?
Sumo is easy, I guess. I think that's GPL version 2 or later. And Veins is also 2 or later. So in that sense, maybe we could convert easily. I think the core promise wants to do that because nobody has time for that. From now maintaining conflicts, it's twice as much. So that was the core motivation behind Veins. Then it's the same, we're not traffic engines. I don't want to know how Sumo works. I don't want to write a single line of code in their code base. We completely failed with meeting that objective, but that was the initial plan. But maybe it's good to keep them separate and say, okay, they do what they know best and we do what we know best. It would be awesome to see them more closely integrated, to do more crazy stuff like optimistic synchronization of the GPU, because right now it's either better on the running or Sumo. Which isn't that bad because what is running Sumo for simulating 3 cars or 400 cars is not. They built Sumo to simulate the city of Cologne. So in that sense, it doesn't really hurt us. But it would just be much more nice to be able to get individual results from the simulation sooner. But there also, it's just a matter of time. We don't have the time to do it. Or the resources. So if somebody gives me a load of money, I'll just start working on that. But it turns out that nobody wants to.
We've taken a look at another traffic simulator. It's called OpenVNS, Open Vehicle Network Simulator. So that comes, there is a library, which is an extension to OMNeT. So then the traffic simulator and the network simulator and the traffic simulator would be talking about your C++ interface. But we're just wondering whether that's the path. With questioning really, because it has a really much less user community of course, than Sumo, of course much less features.
Yeah.
So I don't know whether this is would be something that's worth looking at.
Absolutely. I think this is now the fourth or sort of so simulator that I saw was just created a very highly realistic mobility model for OMNeT or for any speed event simulator really. And they all were brilliant. I mean, they were so much better than Veins ever could, because for tightly coupled, nicely interlinked. But OpenVNS is still alive, I guess, but three of those have already died. Because those two guys maintaining that, they were not from traffic engineering. And so when they got done with their project, they said, okay, you know, the source code is publicly available, feel free to maintain it, and it turns out that nobody wanted it. Sumo is just the traffic simulator. In any paper, what kind of simulator they're using, it's Sumo at 80% or something, and then all of the rest. So I have high hopes that this will just keep going without the passive very nicely. So this is for me the core reason to make a touch traffic simulation. That's what people do it for.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, more close coupling would be nice. To get in the
okay. I mean, anyone else in the audience who was not talking but is working on automotive models and similar stuff? Okay, I'm presentation.
I have perhaps a little bit other topic because we're now seeing that more and more models are interconnected. For example, in your talk, you interconnected the CAM model and the ABP model, and I think there will be more situations this will happen, especially in the in-car domain, because there are other models as well, for example, for other bus systems. So I think there's one problem that there are no consistent interfaces to interconnect those models, and I think that's something we should talk about. How can we define
some common interfaces to interconnect different models in a usable way. So perhaps somebody has a good idea to start some sort of interface definition in the community. I don't have a good idea.
Of course, video networking is concerned. There has been a very successful project by, I think, also from some guys from Berlin, which is called SimRTI, that are just providing a very, very slim core that does synchronization of basically anything that simulates. So you can use OMNeT as a client to that, you can use Sumo as a client to that, you can use two instances of OMNeT and one instance of Sumo, add an application simulator to that, and it's just synchronizing all of these simulators and helping them exchange data. And that works very well, for example.
Is that HLA interface?
I think it's heavily inspired by HLA. I don't know how much of that concept is left, or we have to talk to them. But so this is a concept of doing very nice synchronization. In the end, basically, it's exactly standardizing on some interfaces and just interconnecting the models. But in that sense, because just of its scale, it's also very limited in terms of what it can then actually do. Because once you start abstracting away so much from what is going on, you just have to cut parts of functionality that you need for many projects, which then essentially needs people starting to drill into your interface and basically ruining all of your nice work in the standardization. But it might just be too early to tell how well these projects are. And in terms of linking many models into OMNeT, I think that works very nicely with the recent releases of OMNeT. So we're now using, I think, Veins, which basically is some little bit of Vixen mixed into lots of custom models. We do this with the INET framework, and they do this with CMULP. But that took us a year to get working, but now it is working. Mostly because most of the simulation libraries for OMNeT just aren't prepared to handle runtime instantiation of modules. It feels like everyone is just missing that when they're designing the model, so it's just full of stuff that probably the initialization function does something like schedule event at sim time zero, because obviously this is when I'm being initialized. Turns out this is not where you're initialized if you start with the simulation. Or just the simulation crapping out if anything bleeds the simulation after 30 seconds, because you have messages scheduled to the models that used to be there and they're now just not there anymore. So this cost us almost a year. Now we have the INET framework under control, and we have the CMULP under control, and we run into the Dragon source code when we leave at runtime, but it starts working. So this would be awesome to have better support of OMNeT, or just in terms of just having a common test case that tries to instantiate the model at T+1, and then just hits people over the head if it doesn't work as it should. I think it is even documented in the user manual, right? That you can instantiate stuff at runtime.
Yes.
So people tend to forget that sometimes it's possible. I think it also needs some kinds of crazy incantations to get it right, like build inside and then call whatever, do this in the right order.
Yeah, like 4 or 5 steps.
But it works very nicely.
So what you're talking about is actually a good practice for programming simulation models. So maybe it would be good to have some sort of guide for new model developers. What is good practice, how to solve some problems that later the models are well interconnected.
Yeah, absolutely. Someone should do this.
And first, another question then to you. Do you notice often changes in the models you depend on that break your code?
their template in Lumia.
This is one before the source code, so that's nice.
Oh, okay.
I mean, just to give an example, we used to depend heavily on Mixim. We just say, okay, we are doing our stuff and Mixim is doing their stuff, and that worked brilliantly for as long as Mixim was being actively maintained. But then there was this period of Mixim not being maintained, and we were just creating random extensions to Mixim. So now it's being maintained again, but in that period of time, you just say, okay, this is it. This is the fourth major rewrite of the Mixim API. I ported it 3 times, I won't port it, four times as before. And now nothing of Mixim is left anywhere. But for a time, this is what we were doing, just porting stuff to new APIs and cursing. Because this is something you just don't do. You don't publish an API or anything to change it in the next minor release.
So it would be good to encourage the developers just to give or mark interfaces that they will use stably in the releases and show some more private interfaces in their models to be sure that if those private interfaces can change in the next versions will be used.
Yeah, absolutely. I think Veins is the biggest offender in this category, exposing, I think, 50 methods as public and just keeping changing everything around with everybody. I think part of the problem is that people just aren't software engineers. They're not out there to develop a brilliant API or to maintain the framework. They're out there to do research or to earn money, or both, ideally. The question is how much more effort do we want to put on people? For me, it's so such a nice thing to have the source code anyway, because I know at the point that it is standard in our community to publish not only the results but also what led you to have the results, which feels like alchemy a little bit. And someone said, okay, I can turn metal into gold now. Done. And people are publishing these papers. So even just having the source code is nice. Having a state like API is something you can just dream.
I agree.
But it might be good to just publish this in this upcoming, you know, best practices document. take some time to think about it. But
so just find a maintainer for the document.
Yeah, that's also a big problem. I mean, really having documentations for the wallets. It's brilliant to see this support in OMNeT, just in the menu button, generate documentation, because this is pretty much the only way you get documentation out of most of the source code. Well, I couldn't be bothered to maintain any kind of documentation outside the source code. If I change the API or something, well, I can hardly be bothered to change the comment right on top of the method code. But I might be doing this, and then the documentation is up to me. I won't change PDF file on some different server, on HTML documentation, downloading it, uploading it. That's just too much of a hassle.
Okay.
So this was brilliant, seeing some just support Oxygen out of the box. And so this is how you do your documentation. I think even the manual requirements has some kind of pointer. As to how to document your net files. We are using that filter. So I think the more documentation you can maintain in your source code, the more correct your documentation is. Because this is the 5-year goal when you start changing your source.
Yeah, true.
Coming back to integrating different components, like co-simulation. So is anybody using HLA here? HLA is like high-level architecture. It was defined by the US DOD, Department of Defense, for interoperation of different simulators. And now it's an IEEE standard for some years. And, basically, it's a protocol for synchronizing different simulators. There are a lot of commercial implementations, and also there are at least 2 or 3 open source implementations. There is one most of them are Java based implementations, which is not so good for us. But there are also C++ based ones like CERTI, CERTI. It's maintained by a French guy. It's been around for at least 10 years, but I don't know. Actually, I haven't checked it the last few years where it is, but it seems to be getting old. So is somebody using distributed simulations or co-simulations using HLA or some other thing? Okay, who has heard about HLA before?
But have you actually seen that in wide, that somebody is using for some paper, for some research, actually?
Not really seen that in the
Probably for different areas.
Yeah. I think it's mostly an American military thing. So one simulator is simulating tanks, and the other is simulating fighter planes, and the third one is simulating the operations center and whatever. But in theory, it's completely normal, so you can you can use it for anything. So there's nothing specific to this kind of scenarios, even or in the standard itself. In theory, it's a good way of running co-simulations. Like Tracy could be replaced by HLA.
Does this abstraction layer also allow to integrate real world events?
Yes. It has different synchronization methods. So you can have real time nodes, and you can have only listener nodes. You can also have nodes which inject events. And there are objects, it's called a federation. And the other participants are called federates. And the federates expose objects. And objects have attributes which can be read and written to. And they can broadcast events. Objects can subscribe to events. So it's quite complex. And in theory, there should be substandards like called BOM, I think. So like domain-specific models. So if you simulate whatever, what kind of object it should expose, and what should be the standard names for attributes of those objects. So in theory, that should guarantee that different simulation models from different vendors could interoperate. But when I was actually searching for these BOM models, I haven't found anything. So I don't know if they really exist. Or maybe they're just proprietary, like
So there's still coffee and the other drinks in the neighborhood. We will have lunch also here. And it will be served pizza, actually, to make it easy for all of us. There's vegetarian pizza and meat pizza. So just enjoy, and we will start then at 1 with the next session.
Just before you leave, I just want to confirm the number of participants for the dinner. So I just give a sign and I count you that we have the right number for this evening. So it's
for Megadisha who's not joining. I suppose more people are joining compared to not joining.
Yeah, I don't know.
It's two numbers. I mean,
huh? Yeah, but we have this. We have this.
You can count that.
Yes. And such. So who's not joining the dinner? Unfortunately. Who's not joining the dinner?
Oh, no, not joining. 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay.
So you all lost your free ticket for the next one that's on next. Yeah, and for those of you who want to join, we will meet, what is it, till 7:30 or 7. downstairs to go together to the dinner place. And we will take the ferry. There's a nice ferry ride to the restaurant. If you want to go alone, and you can do this as well, there's also a bus. It takes it rides a little bit faster than the ferry, but you have to go alone. Who wants to do some sightseeing?
When do we need?
Seven downstairs. And there's also details about the dinner place outside in the suburb. Okay?